spacecraft are becoming ubiquitous, and we use them for everything from banking to weather forecasting to deep space exploration in search of alien life. And when you think about spacecraft, you might imagine the Voyager, shown here, launched in 1977, traveling through our solar system. But what these images often show is space as this kind of deep, dark abyss, when in fact, space is composed of billions and billions of particles, known collectively as the space environment. And unfortunately, those particles have the ability to damage or destroy our spacecraft. So what is the space environment? Well, we can think of it as beginning at about 50 kilometers in altitude. This is where the sun's ionizing radiation is strong enough to take off that electron in the outermost shell and create a positive ion and a negative electron. So as you continue to go up, you will continue to encounter these ions and electrons. And that process collectively is known as ionization. The ionized fluid is referred to as plasma. A part of the space environment that people often overlook are kind of the solid objects, not just the charged particles. And you might have heard about asteroids and comets. Asteroids frequently make these flybys, they make the news. But those are quite large. The particles that are most numerous in the space environment are referred to as meteoroids and dust. And these particles are no bigger than the width of a human hair. And there's hundreds and hundreds of billions of them. When it comes to spacecraft survivability, though, most people ignore these really tiny particles. They're not charged, so they don't have the ability to get into the spacecraft electronics and cause damage, and they're not big enough to make a hole. But what we've looked at in the past few years is, can these really tiny particles, who are, again, no bigger than the width of a human hair, but traveling so fast, about 60 kilometers per second, can they actually impact the spacecraft, ionize it, and make a plasma similar to what's already embedded in the space environment, and that plasma then radiates and finds its way into electronic and cause damage. So the first thing we want to determine is just how often are we hit. And so most of the time we like to plot just how big an object is as a function of the impact interval. You can see that on the bottom right. And then we populate this plot with data that we collect. So what I'm showing here is actually a video from something called the Chelyabinsk event. It happened just a few years ago over Russia. And this was a 20-meter diameter asteroid. We had no a priori knowledge that this object was actually going to come in. It was going about 20 kilometers per second. And it was fortunate that we had all these dash cams that were actually able to collect the data. So we were able to determine not only where it came from, but how big it was and how fast it was going. So we put that on our plot. There's also something called the Tunguska event. This was back in the early 1900s, also over Russia. And this was an event that we believe was an asteroid, although there's some question about whether it was actually a comet, that was about 50 to 150 meters in diameter. And then the meteor crater, which is here in Arizona, was also created about 50,000 years ago by a 50-meter diameter object. And as you can see, when we populate this plot, the bigger the object, the less likely it is to impact. There are far fewer of the big ones than there are of the small ones. If you extend that down to the right, you see something called Chicxulub. This was actually the dinosaur extinction event about 65 million years ago. But what about if we extend that to the upper left? And let's look at all those little particles that everyone ignores because they think they're not that important. What about those particles impacting our spacecraft? Could they potentially cause damage and destruction? And so if we extend it up to the upper left, you'll notice that obviously the smaller it gets, the more likely it is to impact something, whether that be Earth or the spacecraft. So something that's about 0.009 meters in diameter, pretty small, occurs about every 30 seconds. So what objects are we talking about? Well, there's two different types. There's the naturally occurring meteoroids and dust. These go about 30 to 60 kilometers per second. And there's so many of them. About 100 billion of these impact Earth's atmosphere every day. That's every day. Compare that to space debris. This is all the junk that we put in space. If you've seen the movie Gravity, this is what we're talking about. About the same size, but these are going a lot slower, about 10 to 12 kilometers per second. So if we're talking about overall energy, it's really the meteoroids are the ones that we have to worry about. Okay, so then the question is, has this happened in the past? And the answer to this is a guarded yes. So the first story I can tell is on the Mariner 4 spacecraft back in 1967. And it was midway between Mars and Earth. Carl Sagan was quoted as saying that this was the most disappointing moment of his life when he found out that the images that mariners sent back, there was no Martians on Mars. So there was a lot of hope that at that time we would find aliens. So as it was coming back, it experienced this kind of anomalous event where over the course of about 15 minutes, they saw 15 impact events. And there was a drop in the temperature, the spacecraft changed its orientation. And so, you know, everything went back to normal, so we didn't think much of it. But then a few months later, the same thing happened, only more impacts. And this time, not only did it change its orientation, but we basically lost our ability to communicate with the spacecraft. So it's now in a derelict heliocentric orbit, wandering out in space. We don't know what hit it. So the big takeaway is it impacted, it was impacted by something. We actually have no idea what it was. So I can move time up a little bit and look at some more recent events. And these are just kind of a snapshot of what we in my lab study. The Olympus communications satellite, which lost gyrostability, so the ability to control its movement, experienced this loss in 1993 during the peak of what's called a meteor shower. So if you've gone up and you've seen these bright shooting stars, there's points when that activity is heightened, and Olympus failed during that time period. Landsat 5, same thing, during the same meteor shower, only quite a few years later. Same thing with Adios 2 and ALOS. The takeaway from this is that it's all suggestive. We can't do great diagnostics on our spacecraft the way we can if something failed on Earth. We just don't have the data capacity. But when we try, there's a reoccurring theme that happens. So I have some listed failures. Surface charging just means that spacecraft are accumulating this charge. Deep dielectric means that the charge manages to get inside. And the percentage is what percentage of all the failures are attributed to that. The takeaway is that half of the time, more than half of the time, we don't know what's going on. So my theory, one of the things that we've been studying for the past 10 years or so, is that when these particles, let's say a meteorite or, space debris, impacts our spacecraft, it's going so fast, it has the ability to strip off that electron and create this plasma. And this plasma, again, is ions and electrons, okay? A positive ion, a negative electron, and they interact with each other. They don't only interact with each other, they expand out into the vacuum of space. And as it's expanding, it's also radiating, very similar to like a mini nuclear bomb. Obviously, on a much smaller time scale, smaller energy scale, but it's the exact same physics. So the question is, can this phenomenon be responsible for at least part of those anomalies that we are now tagging as unknown? So how do we study this data, or how do we collect this data? I have a twofold approach. One is to use ground-based instrumentation and look up. And that means looking up with both optical instruments on the left and a radar on the right. So this is a radar I was stationed at many years ago, halfway between Hawaii and Guam. It's called the Altair radar. And basically what we do is we send radio waves off. It impacts the plasma, reflects, and that signal that you're seeing, that undulating signal, that's the return from the plasma. So we're able to basically look up, use our ground-based instruments, and determine how many particles are coming in, how fast are they. Our second approach is to directly take a particle and impact on a spacecraft material here on Earth. So we collaborate with the Max Planck Institute in Germany, and we use this thing called a vanograph accelerator. It's basically allowing us to accelerate teeny tiny particles, again, hundreds of nanometers to micron size, up to 100 kilometers per second, and have it impact different types of spacecraft material, and then measure what happens when these impacts take place. So the basic idea is we have this vacuum chamber, and we pump it down to conditions that represent what's going on in space. A particle comes in, impacts some sensors. These were donated actually by Lockheed Martin. And then we've built all these sensors at Stanford, plasma sensors, optical sensors, RF antenna, and we put them in the chamber. And then we measure what happens. And again, what we're looking for is the formation of that plasma and the expansion and the radiation. And a lot goes into this data processing, but at the end result, we were able to capture some very visually significant images of these impact events. So even something as tiny as a grain of sand is able to produce enough plasma we believe, to disrupt spacecraft electronics. And these are some images that we've captured here at the NASA Vertical Gun Range, showing kind of how the plasma evolves and even kind of creeps up the wall as time progresses. Finally, what we've done is we've collected all these data. We also want to do a comparison with simulations to basically get at what is truth. And so a few of my students have tackled this thing called a particle and cell simulation. Long story short, we're simulating everything that we're doing in the laboratory. And what we find, what I'm showing here, is basically, again, that plasma radiating. So this emissive pattern that's expanding into space. And the big takeaway, the big aha moment we had, is that when we actually measured these fields, both in the chamber and using simulations, they're over 100,000 times what current spacecraft designers are building to. So when a spacecraft designer builds, they have some specifications. They say, this is the maximum field that I need to worry about. We're saying you are 100,000 times off from what you're currently building. Now, I'm not trying to be arrogant, but there's many of these particles. So you're probably wondering, why aren't spacecraft falling out of the sky? They're tiny. They're tiny. And so when I say tiny, I mean micron-sized plasma. And they have to impact near a specifically sensitive piece of equipment in order to affect it. So my guess, if one of these particles impacts, let's say, a square meter surface once per day, maybe once a year or twice a year, one of those impacts will be close enough to something that could potentially get damaged or destroyed. So what's next? I'm a huge fan of space. Space travel was inspired by Star Trek when I was really little. And I want to build something, and I want to, well, I guess I'm too old now to go into space, but I want to put things in space. So I am designing, or we are designing in my lab, these small miniaturized satellites called CubeSats. And the idea is that we're going to use these as impact detectors and populate these spacecraft with our sensors to try to figure out what's actually going on up there. We're not only going to hopefully deploy these around Earth, but also send them off to asteroids and have kind of a swarm of these spacecraft. And that way we can not only understand what's going on near Earth, but we can characterize the asteroids from which these particles actually emanated from. And then finally, I already mentioned I'm a huge Star Trek fan. The idea here is that even though I started by saying we want to make spacecraft more robust, there's a lot of energy in these impacts. And what we can do is potentially harness them. Similar to explorers, and they didn't take all their resources with them, right? They lived off the land. We can live off our land, which is space, and actually use this as an energy source to not only maybe propel our spacecraft, but to power it, especially as we're getting far from the sun. So with that, thank you for your time.